Welcome to Web of Light. I am here with Angie D'Angie, and I'm Dr. Kevin, and we are your guides for the day.
Guides for the day?
We're your guides for the day. How about Sherpas? You like that? We are Sherpers for the day. You like that?
Sherpers?
Why? What's the face? She's giving me the face. What's the face? You don't like Sherpas? What have you got against Sherpas? They're nice people.
Okay, guides.
So, what's up with you these days? We're moving one step closer to the Web of Light Expo.
Getting closer to the Web of Light Expo. We're running around with Kathy, getting her happy nonprofit gathering together.
Yes, and I always say this wrong because we had like 5,000 different titles that she played around it. It's Misty March Madness.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
See, I wanted magical
mystical.
March Madness. Or mystical. But she changed it to Misty. I don't get that. Sorry. It feels a little damp to me.
Well, maybe it's going to be a misty day in March.
March 4th in Pepperell, Mass. Angie and I are throwing an event, a smaller event, as a fundraiser for Small Town Big Bang.
Which is their Pepperell fireworks for the 4th of July.
Yeah, because Pepperell said, we're too cheap to do fireworks anymore. We can't afford them. We don't want to afford them. And this woman started a nonprofit several years ago and said, our kids deserve fireworks on Dr. Kevin's birthday. Because that's why we celebrate July 4th, right? Because it's my birthday. Is there something else going on that I don't know about?
You know, that's kind of, it's the 240th anniversary for our
You're not supposed to be sharing my age.
Yeah,
age,
I know.
240. I think I look pretty good for, what do you think? Do I look good for 240? Feel free to let us know at Dr. Kevin or Angie at weboflight.com, either one, DRKVAN.
So that, like, to me is, I kind of realized that my daughter's 40, and it's just like, she was a bicentennial baby.
She was a bicentennial baby.
Yeah. So it's like, wow.
Yeah, and your daughter is somebody who definitely has caused fireworks in her life.
Yes, she has.
So I do want to take a second before we move into our quote for the day. I want to welcome some of the new stations we've been picking up. We're continuing to pick up new stations. We have stations throughout New England now, down to New Jersey, over to California. We're picking up stations on a regular basis. If you would like to see Web of Light on your local public access channel, then you can send an email to myself or Angie. Send it to me, because she'll just forward it to me. Just send it to me. DRKEVAN, Dr. Kevin at weboflight.com, and we'll tell you or point you in the right direction for you to actually have our show on your local TV station. Or you can always get it through Hudson TV, where we shoot here in Hudson, New Hampshire, or you can get it at the Web of Light channel that's associated with My Dr. Kevin on YouTube, MyDrKevin on YouTube. But we want to welcome. And, you know, we don't always get notified when you join us, so please let us know if you've come on recently and we haven't given you a big hey and a welcome personally. Send us and let us know what channel you're watching us on, and we will welcome you into our Web of Light family.
And also, I want to express to everybody, if there's something particular that you'd like us to view or have the viewers be able to see, share those comments with us, either at our website or on the Facebook page, you know, or email us directly if you'd like to. But yeah, we'd love to see your comments. We'd love to see your ideas all the time.
Yeah, we're all here. We're here to help support, promote, and be people that are weaving a web of light in the world, bringing more light into the world, more illumination, helping hopefully get out of these dark times that we're in. And the way that one dispels the darkness is by cranking up the light.
Cranking up the light.
Yep. And I'm all about spiritual activism. I know it's hard to tell, but I'm definitely a spiritual activist. You know, I don't mind meditating. I don't mind chanting. I do the Om thing, okay?
You know, one of the things we realize is that negativity can be defeated by positive energy.
Yes.
So the more positive energy that everyone can express and be a part of, the least effective becomes the negative.
You know, and one of the things is we can bring illumination, each one of us, in our own way. Each one of us has a flame inside of us with sometimes discipline, work, courage, stick-to-itiveness. We can turn that flame on. But the flame that we may bring into the world, and trust me, I've been being called a flame for years, the flame that we bring into the world oftentimes may be through our poetry or our art or our music. Mm-hmm. We bring things into the world by sharing part of who we are and bringing that lightness in and making somebody else's day lighter.
Yes.
I mean, how often have you or you out in the audience heard a piece of music or seen a piece of art or maybe heard a story, but you've experienced something and it's just made you feel like you've had a lighter day, a better day, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah. Yeah. So with that, you should start your quote.
And that's what I'm going to do. My first quote today is, art is a collaboration between God and the artist. And the less the artist does, the better, says André Gide. The other one that we have today is, every production of an artist should be the expression of an adventure of his soul, or her soul. And that's by Somerset Maugham. I'm pronouncing that wrong. I'm sure I am. W. Somerset. How do you pronounce that, Angie?
I believe it. You're right. Maugham.
Maugham? Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, look, you know what? If you're looking for perfection, switch the channel now. So what do you think of that? Do we need more art in the world? What do you think?
Art is always needed in the world. The more art you have, the more creative becomes, the more positive is reflected. You know, you think about art, and it's not just in like words that are written. It's in drawings that are drawn. It's in words that are written. It's in theatrical pieces that you might want to put out. It's also in the things that you create on a daily basis.
Absolutely.
And so it's all around you. It's just that people tend to see it so much that they don't realize how much art is really, truly around them.
And I'm going to put a plug in. I've got a new show coming out shortly called Dragons, Unicorns, and Other Creative Creatures, mm-hmm. Where I'm going to be having a show where I'm just highlighting artists of any kind, of any ilk. Anybody who's an artist that does original kinds of work, I don't care whether that's cooking or glass blowing or painting or poetry, we need more art. And somewhere, I can't remember where I read it, but it's one of the indicators of the fall of all of the greatest empires in the world has been when you see a decrease in the creation of new art. And that is a sign that the empire is in decline, when you no longer have artists creating new art. Mm-hmm. Again, of any kind, when we say art, we're talking about broad art. Or art by abroad. Whichever. I don't know. Now, I'm saying that, I'm getting ready to introduce the guest, and I'm in such deep kimchi now.
And, and our guest, it may be very confusing with our guest today because we share the same first name.
Yeah. Yes. Well, you know, you've heard of thing one and thing two, right? So you're going to be Angie one and Angie two. And since you're my co-host, you do get to be Angie one. Though she's the guest for the day.
She should be Angie one.
Okay.
Maybe she should be Angie and I'll be Angie one for the day.
Okay. Or you can be the other Angie.
Yeah.
So today's guest is medium. She's a medium. We made her actually get on the scale. We took a thing out. We measured her. Is medium Angie Butler Welch. She's a psychic medium, an intuitive artist. Angie is a psychic medium and intuitive artist. Her goal is to connect you with your loved ones in spirit, your angels, and your guides, to offer you confirmation, healing, and guidance. With art mediumship, You will receive a unique chalk pastel drawing as she gives you the reading, and the colors all have special meaning. It's a one-of-a-kind experience. Now, you have had this experience, correct?
Oh, I have.
You are the one that actually introduced me to Angie and her wonderful work.
Yes.
So Angie introduced me to Angie, and we have a drawing of hers, and she's actually, because you've had one.
My drawing is up where my children's photos are. My angel is up on the wall of my children.
I know your children. None of them qualify as angels. I don't know what they're doing there. But we have an example of her art in front of us. And Angie is actually not only going to be at the Web of Light Expo offering this service, April 22nd, 23rd, but she's going to do a spirit drawing of me if she has a piece of paper big enough for my ego. I mean, for my angels. Angie, welcome.
Very nice to be here, Dr. Kevin and Angie. Thank you so much for having me.
We're delighted to have you. By the way, I have to say, I love your top.
Channel in my inner artist, obviously, and a little bit of my inner hippie. It's all good.
It's all good.
Inner hippie, inner artist, inner intuitive, all works on this show. So, you know, you've come home. Welcome
Price.
Home.
Yes, I feel like it.
So I'm going to break this into sections, Angie 2 over here, other Angie. Wants to take it in a different direction. But let's start with the role creativity has played in your life. Mm-hmm. We'll get to the psychic, we'll get to the medium, we'll get to the intuitive. But what role has creativity played in your life?
I have to say, just the idea, I love what you were talking about, having a whole show of just focusing on arts and being creative, because that's where your soul speaks. And so I can look back to my childhood, and whether I was a great artist back then or not, it was a way to let my soul speak, usually on paper. I did a lot of drawing and coloring and stuff like that. And for me, I find that there are times for people, if they can't speak what's going on in their mind, their hearts, they can usually create something that gets that out there. So for me, I find it very healing, and I find it a very unique way to communicate, very unique.
Now, have you ever, one of the things that has become much more popular in the last few years has been actually art therapy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, yours would be spiritually therapeutic, but you're not an art therapist.
No, I do not have a degree. You actually do need a real degree to be considered an art therapist. You can say that you do therapeutic art, and I do teach some intuitive art classes, like painting classes, but I can't call myself an art therapist. You have to have a special degree for that.
That's very interesting.
Yep.
Yeah. I kind of knew that, mm-hmm. but so besides the fact that you're going to be coming down at the expo and doing this, and we're going to get into the psychic medium and the intuitive in a minute, but I'm going to spring something because this is what I do to Angie all the time. It keeps her on her toes. She's just so lovely on her toes, especially when she wears her tutu.
Yeah.
So, we could actually, after the expo, at some point, have you come down and teach at our new center.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yep. I actually do teach art mediumship. I do. I have like a basic intro level class. And when I actually teach that class, I have people start off, and by the end of the class, even if it's a 2-hour class, they are doing drawings and readings for people. Because we all have the ability. You just have to find it.
Oh, that's fascinating. I love this.
Now, in other words, they kind of interpret their own style.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you give them that piece, but they interpret their own style. Because I
have yet to find someone that couldn't do it.
Yeah. But I could imagine that if I was to start to pick that up, that I would probably have a certain way of doing that.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't be following you step by step.
No.
Right?
No,
so
that's
pretty interesting. That would be interesting to have at our center.
Yeah.
I'm excited. I think that what we need to do is, before we let them disappear back to the wilds of Maine.
It is a long drive. Because Maine is a pretty big state.
Yeah, you can. Because I was born and raised in Maine.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I was born in New Hampshire, but I was raised in Maine. I lied. But you can fit all the rest of New England in Maine. I always remember that growing up as a kid. That would always be the thing. You could take all the rest of New England and you could put it in Maine and there'd still be room left over. Yep. You know, and then you could take all the people in Maine and put them in Rhode Island and there'd still be room left over.
Funny how that works.
Wide open spaces.
I don't think so.
But definitely, before we get you and your husband is also going to be on another show today, another show with us later on. And he's actually going to be playing some music when you're drawing for us. Before we get you on into the expo, we should definitely set up a time that we can promote at the expo for people that want to learn how to do this, because I just think that this is fabulous. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It really is fun. And as I said, for me, it's a way to get ego out of the way. When I was really exploring my mediumship and really pushing forward with that, doing the art allowed my ego to do something else. Yeah. And then everything else just comes forward. So it's a great way to help people when they're just exploring and trying to learn, because it does give your mind something to do when you're playing with colors, and mm-hmm. then you just allow yourself to speak.
Yeah. Now, you know, because when I think about the concept that you're bringing out here, it makes me think sometimes they have those paint and wine or, you know, those parties.
I do those.
Do you do those?
I do. I call them intuitive painting classes or ignite your artistic fire is what I call it. And I will start with, for example, say we were doing a tree of life. I will paint as I'm there, but I allow people to choose the shape of their canvas, choose the colors that they use.
Oh, nice.
I kind of guide them in the basics of how to do it, and then I walk around, I'm helping them. And while I'm doing that, I'm also giving them messages, because what people don't realize, and you'll find out, Dr. Kevin, when you do this, there's a reason why people choose certain colors.
Yes.
There's messages involved with the colors, and when they are actually painting their own things, I can look at, oh wow, look at their roots, or oh, like in a tree, or look at the way that their branches are coming out, and look at how this is facing that way, and so I can do an entire message from the painting that they've created. So those are really fun too.
So that is
I love doing
those. See, he doesn't know it yet, but I want to bring in a paint and wine night or something of that idea.
I would love to do that.
Well, I like fire. Ignite
your artistic fire.
Ignite your artistic fire. Because instead of wine, I could do fireball whiskey.
Wine. There you go.
No.
What?
I don't want any, no liquors involved, because we want to be able to allow as many as can come in to join us and enjoy.
So what does that mean? Well, I'm not going to force anybody else to drink. That means less alcohol for me. Hey, you're drinking cinnamon coffee.
I like to
drink cinnamon whiskey. Like, what's wrong with that? Is there anything wrong with that?
Spice of life.
There we go. Okay. So you've been creative your whole life. It has now melded. Talk about your psychic medium. Now, do you separate out psychic medium and intuitive? And if so, why and what are the differences?
Actually, I do. And I explain that to a lot of people. Some people do not understand the difference between a psychic and a medium. And an intuitive and a psychic, I kind of put in similar ballpark. I always say a psychic is somebody who can tap into your energy, can see what's going on, can give you an idea of potential possibilities, how those might play out. Same thing with an intuitive. You can feel things and you have a good idea. A medium, while all mediums are psychic, not all psychics are mediums, because a medium has that additional level of connection to be able to communicate with spirit, with our loved ones in spirit. Mm-hmm. So I will say sometimes I'm a spiritual interpreter. I have three-way conversations when I'm doing readings, talking to you, talking to them, talking to me, talking to you, talking to them. So that's how I say the difference.
Been there.
Yeah, you got it. Yeah. You understand it. Yeah, but there is a difference, and some people don't realize that.
Brings new meaning to multiple personality disorder. Well, I always find it, and I pick on everybody, so please don't take
this
personally.
I got broad shoulders, honey. It's all good.
That's all right. I called you an artist broad before I introduced you by accident. I always pick a little bit when people say they're psychic mediums, because I'm like, you really can't be a medium without being psychic.
Exactly.
But you can absolutely be psychic and not be a medium.
Exactly, which is what...
yeah.
what I always tell people, because it is so confusing, and people will interchange the terms, and they're really not the same.
No, no. I mean, Angie and I both do mediumship. Mm-hmm. We both talk to dead people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes dead people talk to us when we don't want them mm-hmm. to.
And that's why you see me. I work with the title of spiritual consultant.
Mm. Yeah.
Because I am the intuitive, but I also have the spiritual piece that comes in. So I kind of feel that that's a spiritual consultant, not a psychic.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and it's interesting. And they're all words. So... So you've defined the difference. So when did you first discover your mediumship abilities or your psychic abilities? Which came first for you?
Mm-hmm. The mediumship part, my earliest memory of being able to communicate with somebody who wasn't there, somebody who had passed on, was when I was 4 years old. Mm-hmm. And I still very specifically remember the details of that. I had been asked to go downstairs at a friend's house to take something out of the dryer for my friend's mom, take a towel out of the dryer. And I can remember so clearly walking downstairs, taking a towel out of the dryer, turning around. Now, mind you, this was in the late 70s. Turning around, seeing the pool table, and watching two guys playing pool, which was whatever. And there's smoke downstairs because they're all smoking. But what I noticed was this... as I referred to her as a grandmother in a rocking chair. And it didn't bother me that there was two guys playing pool that I had no idea who they were. I didn't know who the grandmother was. And so I went upstairs and I asked my friend's mother, who's the Grammy downstairs? Because she wasn't the Grammy that I knew for my friend. It wasn't my friend's grandmother. And she said, there's nobody down there, Angie. And I said, no, there is. There's a Grammy down there. Who's the Grammy downstairs? And again, I was told there's nobody downstairs. And I said, yes, there's two guys playing pool and there's a Grammy. I don't know who the Grammy is. At 4 years old, that was where my mind was, is who is this Grammy? And they took me downstairs. There was nobody down there. There was nobody playing pool. There was no grandmother. And that was my first clear recollection. And I had many more experiences like that when people would pass away. They would come visit me before they would pass away. And so this has happened all my life, but that's my earliest memory.
Now, when did you delineate that you were a medium and also psychic in other than medium mm-hmm. ways?
Yep. Certainly with the premonitions and dreams, that happened, I remember being like probably junior high age. I would have dreams and then things would happen. Usually within a day or two, those same sort of things would happen. So for that... because I didn't understand the mediumship stuff. I didn't have a term to give to it. I just knew that sometimes when people died, I could see them. The psychic piece, when you're kind of a teenager, you understand what that piece is. So, yeah, I would say it was probably like junior high that I can remember, again, having dreams is where it usually would come, would be with dreams.
Okay, and this is a very generational thing mm-hmm. because... I'm not going to speak for Angie, but when my psychic abilities were showing up, which started at 4, and my mm-hmm. grandmother talked to me about it,
mm-hmm.
But she talked to me about it. She never used the word psychic. But I went through years of doing psychic stuff and mediumship stuff, but nobody was talking about psychics because I'm just enough older than you.
Gotcha.
When you came along, mm-hmm. they were talking about psychics. When Angie and I first came out, they only ever talked about psychotics.
Yeah.
Similar, but not the same.
Psychotics, narcotics. yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, you know.
Well, so you were fortunate. You had somebody... that you could talk to at yeah. that young age. Because I really didn't.
Yeah, well, you had somebody to talk to, but they were all dead.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. It's so it's like, I just kind of, it was an oddity to me because I couldn't understand why nobody else could see something. But at the same time, it was always shrugged off.
Well, but you know, you got to look at it. It's parody mm-hmm. because it was an oddity to you and you were an oddity to everybody else. So it's parody.
You're right.
I understand that. I walked that walk. I haven't walked it in heels some days.
So, but, you know, and it's true, because by the time I got into my, actually it was my teens that I finally found somebody that would mm-hmm. mentor and help me to understand.
Yeah, I remember taking a book out of the library. It was the divination, some kind of like an encyclopedia of divination and prophecy, and taking it out of the library in high school to actually learn, because I had nobody to teach me anything. And I wanted to know more about how come I could do this, or how come I knew this, or just have someone teach.
Now, where were you raised?
Northern Maine, Lee.
Lee, Maine.
Lee, Maine. Oh, way up, way up north.
Because you have up there, because you have Camp Edna up there.
I actually own a cottage at Camp Edna. Yeah. So it's a beautiful place up there. It's a spiritualist association, one of the oldest, I believe the second oldest in the United States. And it's all just this place where there's mediums and healers. That's all who basically owns cottages there. But summertime opens up, and we have a program that goes all summer. So it's very nice up there.
Nice.
You should come check it out.
Well, I know that I had mentioned it to your husband. I'm assuming I can't remember whether you were standing there or not when we had the conversation, but of course, my grandmother was a platform medium there.
Wow, that's very cool.
In like 1912 or 1916
yep.
or something.
Yep.
When it was mm-hmm. the largest spiritualist camp in the country.
Yes, yeah. And it still is, I mean, it's still pretty good size. And I believe we've got around 40 cottages that are functional. There had been a fire in the 20s, and then there had been another fire that they lost a lot of the cottages. But it is, I believe, paramount to New England.
Is this similar to the place in New York?
Lilydale,
yes. Yeah, I believe Lilydale is actually the oldest, and then Camp Etna is second.
Yeah, and then you have Casadega.
Casadega down in Florida.
Down in Florida.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
But, you know, people hear of Lilydale and they hear of Casadega, but it seems like they don't hear about Camp Etna as much.
This is the first I hear of it, honestly.
Yeah, and I grew up knowing about it because mm-hmm. my grandmother...
Yeah.
Well, actually, I didn't grow up. I didn't find out till later. I was an adult when I found out that she had actually done mediumship work there, which is why she recognized my psychic gifts.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, when did you go professional, so to speak? And what was the impetus?
Yeah. I would say I've been doing the art mediumship, like, out there professionally for about 4 years. And what happened was, before that, I would always, at one point, had been married to my previous husband was a very, I always say, black and white Christian. So I had to really suppress a lot of mm-hmm. my gifts. And you get to a point, as you probably know, you can only suppress that stuff for so long, and then it pushes out of you. And I would journal a lot, and I would draw pictures. Usually just with like a little mechanical pencil, and I would draw a picture, and then I would write something, and then step back and go, wow, that's the answer to my question, or this makes sense with what I've been trying to figure out. What I didn't realize was I was actually channeling in from guides. And so I'd have a picture and then a message. And I did find a wonderful mentor, and she was watching me do that stuff, and she said, you do realize, Angie, that will be your outlet. That will be what you'll be doing. And I mm-hmm. thought she was crazy. Yeah.
So, what came first? The upgraded realization that you had this gift from God and people who didn't mm-hmm. get it needed to go away? Or you upgraded husbands? Which came first?
Oh, wow. That's a loaded question. Honestly, I was really well on my spiritual path, and then had separated from my now ex-husband and divorced, and I had met my now current husband before that. We were friends, and so he was just more of a spiritual confidant, somebody that I could talk to, and it just kind of went from there. We have certainly done some past life regression work and found out, oh, wow, we've been connected a few times before, so it all makes sense coming together now. But yeah, as I said, I had suppressed so much of it, and then spirit just kept pushing and pushing and pushing, and
yeah. Well, I kind of sort of did know the order, because we had a couple of conversations, but I wanted our listeners to hear
gotcha.
The order.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of people out there that stay in a bad marriage.
Yeah.
Stay in a bad place. Mm-hmm. Stay trapped. They feel like, you know, they can't you know, whether it's because they have children or because they are, you know, their spouse makes really good money or is their security blanket or whatever. And I've had people, probably Angie, my Angie, has as well, where they come and they'd be like, well, you know, if I could just feel my, find my, my spiritual partner, then I'd go out in the world. And I'm like, you know, you really got to take care of the husband first that you're stuck with. Like, like it doesn't work in that order usually. Usually you got to like clean the bed out before you try to refill it.
Probably a good idea.
Just saying. So it's really good. You empowered yourself to follow your spiritual path.
Yes.
You went out into your spiritual path, and in part of being out in your spiritual path, you ended up stepping into what, seeing the two of you together, I would refer to as the great love of your life.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. I am truly blessed. I say that all the time. We've been together now for about 4 years. We got married in August, and it's still very oftentimes like we've just been dating for a couple of weeks. So it's wonderful.
Yeah.
What is your wedding anniversary date?
August 6th.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sorry, this is August 20th. That's why I had to ask.
Yep.
Yeah, my marriage is coming. Ain't here yet. I still got a few months to run away. No.
You're not going to do that.
Nah, you met my fiance.
Yep.
Okay, so we're going to have you do a drawing of me.
Awesome.
You know, and do it just like, so what you're going to see here is what you would experience at the Web of Light Expo.
Yes.
You come and sit down, and now there, obviously, there's going to be people all around. Mm-hmm. There's going to be a crowd, stuff like this. Does that ever interfere with, do you find that distracting or anything?
I think that's a good question. I think it's a question I get asked by probably at least 50% of the people that will sit down at a fair with me and say, are you sure you can do this with all these people around?
Uh-huh.
Absolutely. What I find is I just have this little bubble when I'm doing a reading, when I'm working with someone. We just kind of create this little energetic bubble, and I'm with the person, and I'm with the drawing, and with the messages, and all of that other stuff just kind of goes away. It doesn't even, like, interfere.
Isn't it amazing?
It is amazing, because you wouldn't think so. Like, the average person would think, how can you even concentrate on that? But I think when you have that connection with spirit, you have that direct connection coming down. Boys, I just had my whole main accent coming out. Did you hear that?
Yeah.
You have your connection coming down. And so you're able to block out all of that.
Yeah.
It's very, it's just a wonderful feeling to realize that you can be in that space and not let any of the outside functions bother you.
Exactly.
It's just amazing.
Yeah. And, you know, and I'm going to put this out there, and then we're going to go ahead and get the drawing started. But, you know, sometimes people will say to me, how do I know the difference between a good intuitive or a good psychic or to go to the right person or stuff like this? And one of the keys is a good professional psychic can literally do it anywhere because there is something where you create the energy of sacred space.
Yep.
And so when, sometimes if you go to these fairs and these expos or you see these, you know, sometimes what I call sideshow psychics, you'll see them very distracted. You'll see them very much not like fully intensely present, and they don't know how to create that. Mm-hmm. And there's a difference between the hobbyist psychic, the professional psychic, and the scam artist psychic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
And they're all out there, trust me. And we've all run across them. Okay, so I am here. I am delighted. Do me.
That does not surprise me coming out of you.
And we are going to have some music going on while she's doing this. And the music is by your husband.
Yes, Wachian. Yep.
Wachian.
Yes, Wachian. I got it. who is going to be doing a separate show with us, so you'll meet him at a different show, but we are going to be treated to his Native American flute music while you're drawing.
Okay, great. And so what I normally tell people when we get started, and this will be a very short version, because if somebody sits with me, it's usually a 20-minute session. It's like a 15-minute reading. I put in extra time to package everything up, so it's very professional when it goes home with you. But I like to tell people, I never know who's going to come through. I connect with your loved ones in spirit. I connect with angels, guides. Sometimes animals come in. I don't know what's going to happen until we do it. I don't know what your picture is going to look like until we do it. What I do know, it will always be something positive, something beneficial, something light-filled. Okay?
Great.
Wonderful. So, Dr. Kevin, there are two things you need to do for me, and the rest is all me. Okay? So, first, you need to come in a little bit closer here. I'm actually going to scoot this table just a little bit. Okay, I need you to pick out three colors, any three colors, and take them right out. And just so people can see, we are starting with a completely blank piece of paper. One of my big investments, baby wipes. Fabulous, okay. Now, and that doesn't mean that these are the only colors that will show up on here, but these are the initial colors. So now this is the other thing you need to do. With each one of those chalks, I want you to put something on the paper for me. Could be a line, a swirl, a scribble. Doesn't matter what it is. You can't do it wrong. All you're doing is putting energy on the paper.
Okay.
Fabulous. Okay. So now, just so you guys will be able to see again kind of this before and after, this is what we're starting with, okay? All right. So just as I get started, what I do want to tell you first, Dr. Kevin, is I do have a female that comes in spirit, female above you. I know you've been talking a lot about your grandmother. I feel like this is probably her energy, and not just because you've been saying it, she thinks this is really cool. And just the...
And she would.
Okay. Just the colors that you've got in here. Not only does she come in with a lot of love for you, she comes in just with a lot of pride, and a lot of pride for you following your dream. And she just says never, 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 never settling, never saying no. The first color that I see here is this pink. I'll try to show it a little bit in here, this pink. Pink to me is almost always a mother or a grandmother, 99% of the time. So I'm actually gonna start with this in here. She has big energy, by the way. Sometimes that might mean that the person, you might need that. Your hands might be messy. Sometimes that means that the person was a larger person. When I see that they come in with big energy, sometimes it's just the energy that they provide. She still talks to you a lot. She still acts as a guide very much in your life. So this pink, first coming about on her head, really talking to me about love and you putting that out there and you really being an ambassador of love to the world and that being a huge priority for you. Next color that you've got here is this light blue. Blues to me, I tend to reference things a lot with chakras. So of course, pink is one of those heart chakra colors, but blue is your throat chakra. It's all about communication. There's a difference between a light blue and a dark blue. Light blue is somebody who is very comfortable in their communication. What I'm hearing is not only this image is going to be of your grandmother, and it represents her, but it also represents a lot of stuff about you. Okay, so the light blue being very comfortable in your communication, and that being part of why you're here. And again, I get referenced back to that love and that just spreading the love, and that really kind of being a soul mission for you. Okay. I have to tell you, I know we did talk a little bit about Camp Etna. If you were to go there, I feel like you would actually be led around by your grandmother. I feel like she would take you around, okay? She keeps talking to me too about, for her, I don't know what this means, but the importance of wearing dresses. So I don't know if there was something significant about, she's talking about the importance of wearing dresses. I don't know what that means.
I'll have to think about it.
Yeah, I give it to you. Okay, just as I ask her a little bit more about it, she's talking about the putting yourself out there. And for her, when she really wanted to make a statement, It was, you had to go out in a dress and you had to look a certain way so that people would take you seriously. And she's actually just talking about you being able to put yourself out there no matter what. Sometimes I have to figure out where they're going with this. You being able to put yourself out there no matter what and still making a statement. That you don't have to, you don't have to dress a certain way to get your point across. You don't have to dress a certain way to feel respected. She felt like she did when she went out into the public, okay? All right, so this other color that you have here is kind of this very interesting pinkish purple. So purple, if we were going with, and I'll actually bring this one in as well, this darker purple, because that's what she's telling me. I'm gonna bring this in here. My people often look like angels when I'm doing them, okay? She's asking me to bring in the darker purple, and I will bring in the lighter purple. Purple to me is a spiritual color. We're talking about your crown chakra, right? When I have this pinkish purple color come in here, again, that tells me that somebody's purpose spiritually is still about love. So I just see that being, again, so paramount in who you are and why you're here.
I was very torn between the purple you're using and the purple I chose.
I have
it. It was my last choice. I was like, which one of these do I want? She said only three.
And that's what, like I told you, it doesn't mean that you'll be limited to those colors. It just means those are the first prominent ones. And I think the fact that I've got two different colors that really represent love, and then this color again being more about spiritual love. Your grandmother, by the way, likes your fiancé.
Oh.
She approves. Whether or not you would think that she would have, she absolutely does.
No, she would have.
She's very, very big with honesty and love. And she keeps talking about honesty, about that being so important, saying that there have been people in your past that honesty was not their priority, and how honesty is a very big thing in your relationship right now. She's very happy about that, very proud of that, okay? Also, I will tell you, you have I want to say that it's probably a small dog because the energy feels like dog, so it's either hers or it's yours that comes in with her. So it's either hers or yours, but it's either a small dog or a big cat because it's that size, okay? And again, it does kind of, it's come with her, so it very well could be hers. Do you have a question?
Like no, I do. No, I just, I would say that it's probably hers.
Okay.
I keep thinking it's a Maine Coon cat.
That would be a big cat that might look like a small dog. And again, if we were doing this at the expo, or if I had, you know, was doing this privately with someone, we would go a lot longer with the session, but I want to make sure that I get this in the amount of time. The last color that I'm being told to add in here is the yellow. Yellow to me is about your intuition. It's about trusting yourself. It's about having faith in yourself, having no fear. I'm also hearing for you, yellow is a power color because it is about spreading the light. And she's showing me with her, I see this big bright yellow light behind her. I also take it as a very divine color. So she is probably residing in the place with the angels very often. I see that color sometimes come through. Do you have any questions for your grandmother? I know you talk to her all the time. She just said, she goes, oh, he talks to me all the time.
Yeah, I do talk to her all the time. What does she think of my fiance's career choice?
It's not, what she says is it's not as true, and I don't know what you're, just so we're all clear, I have no idea what he does. She says it's not as traditional. It's not as traditional for providing the income, like the solid income, but she said he needs to follow his heart. I'm feeling a little pulled, like I don't know if he's doing that right now.
Well, he wants to go back to school, and so it's kind of the incoming career that I was asking about.
Okay.
So
for right now, what she's making me feel like is he's not following his heart right now with what he's doing.
Yeah.
That makes sense to me. She does say it's very important that he does follow his heart because he needs to be happy with what he's doing.
Yeah.
He needs to feel happy when he's doing it. Otherwise, it just becomes a job.
Yeah.
Okay. The last thing that I will say that she is showing me, and I feel like this is something for you, she actually places a big piece of rose quartz in front of you. And I don't know that she would have done anything with stones before, but she's wanting you to, you need some more rose quartz around you, but also around your fiance. So that could just be that could just be for your fiance to just open the heart chakra up a little bit more again when you make when he's making that choice as to what he's going to do.
Okay.
Because I feel like he knows, but he's still a little uncertain about it.
Well, he's uncertain about how to make the pathway work. He's trying to get there, but it's not a short or quick path.
Yeah. Yeah, that would make sense to me. That would make sense to me. Okay, so just as I have this in here, oh, last thing, bleeding hearts. Your grandmother's showing me bleeding hearts. If it doesn't make immediate sense to you, I actually feel like it was a flower she had that she might have had growing someplace around her.
Okay.
But if it doesn't make immediate sense, what I do know is when they show me something like that, it's usually an additional message, especially when I'm short on time. So look up the spiritual meaning of the bleeding heart. It's not a bad thing or anything like that.
I mean, what it makes me think of is a picture I have of her when I was very small, and she is standing over me, and she has a big bouquet of red roses.
Okay, and that could be, because I do see them as being that very deep color.
So okay.
It could very well be.
Okay, there's something else it could mean too.
Okay, we'll go a little deeper with it.
Yeah.
Sometimes when they only give me little bits, it's because it's not so much for me to figure out as it is for you to figure out.
Yeah, okay. I think that this is actually her feeling, her telling me that her heart bled for some of what I went through in my childhood.
I could totally get that. And as I said, it's not a bad thing. I don't feel it as being anything bad. It's something that she's giving you, and I feel like it's some sort of a connection. So that would make sense to me.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Kind of compassion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So just kind of in this little quick, brief little thing that we just did here, what I tried to capture was the image of the energy that I was seeing of your grandmother. Very often they do kind of look like angels. Not all my pictures look like this. Sometimes I've got landscapes. Sometimes I have animals. I never know. But with her, I was seeing the layers of energy, almost like you would see in the auras. And this is just kind of what she was showing me.
Okay.
So I will actually package it up for you. But as we started out with that like white piece of paper and then your couple of little marks, we have some boom, burst of color. So I'm going to package it up for you so it actually looks pretty and you can take it home.
And hang it up on my wall.
And you can hang it up on your wall. What I have found, too, with some people, and yes, I rely on good old-fashioned Aquanet as a setting spray for my artwork so that it doesn't get all messy. So I'm just going to quickly give it a quick spray. What I have found, too, is the energy will often stay in with these colors. So don't be surprised if down the line, as you're looking at it, you get additional messages yourself that come through there. Okay? Do you have any questions?
No, it was quite fascinating, a quite fascinating experience. Definitely right on. Not a big surprise that this particular grandmother would come through, especially because you have a connection to a place that had deep meaning to her.
Yeah, yep. It wouldn't surprise me either if you were to come down. Oh, that's interesting. I have one more thing I'm going to point out to you afterwards. If you were to actually, or come up, I should say, to Camp Etna, I could actually probably walk around with you and help you find some places where she might have liked. She keeps taking me to a certain spot there. It's called the Healing Rock. That's where she keeps taking me. So I feel like if you went down there and I just kind of left you, you would probably have a nice experience. The last thing I noticed on here was there was a little blob of purple, and she said make sure to give him the purple heart. And so I just added this little purple heart on there.
Oh, nice.
She just asked me to add on. So, and again, I get a lot for you about just that spiritual love coming through and recognizing everybody spiritually, that being one of your big major soul missions while you're here.
So, Angie, now you had this experience. Mm-hmm. How did that compare to the experience you had with her when we were up at the expo?
A little bit different.
Yeah, they all will be.
Yeah. However, I found it kind of interesting that you were saying that after, and you've gotten people have told you that they've connected with the art. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely will agree. It's on my wall where all my pictures are hanging for my family. And on occasion, I will get like resonating into that picture and some thoughts or ideas on things.
Especially if you have a guide that comes through. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've heard some really amazing stories from people when I've done the image of a guide for them, mm-hmm. how that's a really quick, easy way for them to meditate and just lock right in and communicate with that
guide. And
that's
exactly what mine was doing.
Yeah, that makes sense to me.
Well, very nice, very nice. And so you teach art mediumship workshops.
I do. And there you are.
Oh,
all packaged,
beautiful.
And professional, ready to go.
With the purple heart.
We'll make sure that we get some pictures of you and me and that and Miss Thing too. we're wearing harmonious pieces today.
Are we?
Yes, your stones are beautiful.
So now, where are you located now?
Bangor, Maine. So it's up there. I do have the cottage at Camp Etna, so I'm in Etna a lot during the summer. But honestly, I travel all over the place. I do house parties and classes and stuff all over the place. And I've actually gone as far as Connecticut to do big parties.
Okay. Yep. I used to live up in Pittsfield. So I know the area. I know Bangor.
Yep.
People who are struggling psychics, struggling mediums, mm-hmm. struggling artists who feel like there's not a place in the world for them, what message do you have for them?
I would say you have to go inside and trust yourself. And we all have something unique to offer. Sometimes we just have to figure out what that is. Sometimes other people can see it in us, and we might not have the faith that that's going to work. That certainly is what happened with me with doing the art mediumship. I was very nervous the first time, and honestly, I still, after 4 years, get nervous when I go to do a drawing with someone or go to help teach them something. But you just have to find what works for you, and you have to be true and authentic to yourself. Too many people try to be someone else, and you can't. You just have to be you.
Yeah, okay.
But we all have the gifts.
Right.
And you know, it's when you say that, it actually makes me realize that that is a part that shows that you are like a true medium, primarily because I find that no matter how long you're in this, when something gets a spark, mm-hmm. It's still like that exciting moment for you.
Yep.
And I also notice that some of those that are not in that true mediumship moment don't get that spark.
Yeah. I definitely have that moment of fear.
Yeah.
Before every party, before every fair, before every teaching event, every psychic dinner, mm-hmm. every whatever I do, I have to just say, okay, it's all you and me, and let's do this together.
Well, good. Well, we want to thank you very much for coming. Again, yes. This is medium Angie Butler. She's a medium, an intuitive artist. Her goal is to connect you with your loved ones in spirit, your angels, your guides, to offer you confirmation, healing, and guidance. With art mediumship, you'll receive a unique chalk pastel drawing that she gives you as part of your reading. Colors all have a special meaning. It's a one-of-a-kind experience. I will testify to that. It was definitely a one-of-a-kind experience. I've never had one like this before.
Good.
And you are going to be offering your services.
Yes.
At the Web of Light Expo.
Very excited to come down to New Hampshire for 2 days to do that. That's very exciting.
Earth Day weekend, April 22nd and 23rd. And by that point, I'm pretty confident that we're going to have you scheduled down to come down for a weekend and teach something at the Web of Light Healing Center.
That would be great.
Sure, that would be.
Bundle it up, put a couple of fun things in there.
Yeah. We'll get some stuff. We'll get some stuff going on for you.
Good.
So thank you for coming.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's great to see you again.
Yes.
In all of us, we are creators and creative. In all of us springs forth a uniqueness that we are here to present to the world. Never let anyone tell you that however you choose to express art, creativity, or yourself, if it is integrity with who you are, don't let anyone tell you that it's wrong. It's only wrong when you're doing it according to somebody else's idea of who you should be. So as you step forward today, claim the gift to the world, the unique, one-of-a-kind gift to the world that you are. Namaste.